14 Russian Tsars. Narration, Katie Haigh. Alexander II, Emperor of Russia. Alexander II, 1818 to 1881, Emperor of Russia, eldest son of Nicholas I, was born on the 29th of April, 1818. His early life gave little indication of his subsequent activity, and, up to the moment of his accession in 1855, no one ever imagined that he would be known to posterity as a great reformer. Insofar as he had any decided political convictions, he seemed to be animated with that reactionary spirit which was predominant in Europe at the time of his birth, and continued in Russia to the end of his father's reign. In the period of 30 years during which he was heir apparent, the moral atmosphere of St. Petersburg was very unfavourable to the development of any originality of thought or character. It was a time of government on Martinet principles, under which all freedom of thought and all private initiative were as far as possible suppressed vigorously by the administration. Political topics were studiously avoided in general conversation, and books or newspapers in which the most keen-scented press censor could detect the least odour of political or religious free thinking were strictly prohibited. Criticism of existing authorities was regarded as a serious offence. The common policeman, the insignificant scribe in a public office, and even the actors in the imperial theatres were protected against public censure as effectually as the government itself. For the whole administration was considered as one and indivisible, and an attack on the humblest representative of the imperial authority was looked on as an indirect attack on the fountain from which that authority flowed. Such was the moral atmosphere in which young Alexander Nikhailovich grew up to manhood. He received the education commonly given to young Russians of good family at that time, a smattering of a great many subjects, and a good practical acquaintance with the chief modern European languages. Like so many of his countrymen, he displayed great linguistic ability, and his quick ear caught up even peculiarities of dialect. His ordinary life was that of an officer of the guards, modified by the ceremonial duties incumbent on him as heir to the throne. Nominally, he held the post of director of the military schools, but he took little personal interest in military affairs. To the disappointment of his father, in whom the military instinct was ever predominant, he showed no love of soldiering, and gave evidence of a kindliness of disposition and a tender-heartedness which were considered out of place in one destined to become a military autocrat. These tendencies had been fostered by his tutor, Zhukovsky, the amiable humanitarian poet, who had made the Russian public acquainted with the literature of the German Romantic school, and they remained with him all through life, though they did not prevent him from being severe in his official position when he believed severity to be necessary. In 1841, he married the daughter of the Grand Duke Louis II of Hesse, Maximilienne Wilhelmine Marie, thenceforward known as Maria Alexandrova, who bore him 6 sons and 2 daughters. He did not travel much abroad, for his father, in his desire to exclude from Holy Russia the subversive ideas current in Western Europe, disapproved of foreign tours and could not consistently encourage in his own family what he tried to prevent among the rest of his subjects. He visited England, however, in 1839, and in the years immediately preceding his accession, he was entrusted with several missions to the courts of Berlin and Vienna. On the 2nd of March, 1855, during the Crimean War, he succeeded to the throne on the death of his father. The first year of the new reign was devoted to the prosecution of the war, and after the fall of Sevastopol, to negotiations for peace. Then began a period of radical reforms, recommended by public opinion and carried out by the autocratic power. The rule of Nicholas, which had sacrificed all other interests to that of making Russia an irresistibly strong military power, had been tried by the Crimean War and found wanting. A new system must, therefore, be adopted. All who had any pretensions to enlightenment declared loudly that the country had been exhausted and humiliated by the war, and that the only way of restoring it to its proper position in Europe was to develop its natural resources and to reform thoroughly all branches.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.